We looked last time at some properties of first passage times, and I'd like to elaborate this a little bit. I mentioned the so-called backward Kolmogorov equation. Let me show you what it is explicitly and how you can get information on first passage times, first passage time distributions using the backward Kolmogorov equation, for instance. Now, there are several ways of looking at this problem of finding first passage times. And the canonical problem which we looked at was first passage from the origin to some point x for a particle undergoing Brownian motion on the x-axis. We already found the distribution of the time that it hits the point x for the first time. We discovered this distribution. It was a Levy distribution. I want to show you a little bit more about how you attack first passage time problems in general. In particular, we'd like to look at it on fractals, which I mentioned earlier. But before that, let me show you a couple of ways of finding first passage time distributions. The first of these has to do with what's called a renewal equation. For the first passage time, and it goes like this. It's most comfortably illustrated using discrete valued Markov process. So remember that for a discrete valued Markov process, we label the states I, J, K and so on, and we'll assume the process to be stationary. And then the quantity of interest is the probability P that you are in some state K at time t, given that you started from some state J at time 0, for instance. This was the conditional probability, and K, J, etc. label the states of the system. Okay. Now, in particular, if for example you have in mind a lattice on which diffusion is taking place or random walk is taking place, so that these states are ordered in some sense, then you see there is a simple equation which does the following. If these are the states that we are talking about, and let us suppose that this is state J and this is state K out there, J is less than K, and we'd like to know for a system starting in state J, what's the first passage time distribution for it to get to some state I in between. So we have in mind this geometry, and the observation is that there's no way that the system can go from J to K without going through the state I in this geometry. Okay. So the probability that it's at the state k at time t, given that it started j at time 0, this must be equal to an integral over intermediate times dt prime 0 to t, the probability that it's at k in the time interval t minus t prime from the intermediate state I, times the probability that it hits the state I for the first time at time t prime, given that it started from j at time 0. As you know, our notation has been such that we omit this. So this is called a renewal equation. It says the probability that you start at 0, at t equal to 0 in state j, and you reach the state k at time t, must be equal to the probability that you start at J and hit the state I for the first time here at some time t prime, which is in between 0 and t, and then the rest of the time you spend in propagating from I to this final state k. Okay. Remember, this is a first time probability, whereas this does not say anything like that at all. In between, it could have gone past k, it could have gone either way any number of times and then ended up at the state k. But this says that you did not hit I before t prime. Okay. And this is called a renewal equation. This thing renews itself each time, you as if the whole thing is starting from the point I, it is now propagating to t. So it is called a, it is an example of a renewal equation. It is satisfied by a class of processes even more extensive than just Markov processes, but this is immediately going to tell you how to compute this quantity here, because notice that this is in the form of a convolution. So if I define Laplace transforms with respect to time, then it immediately implies that P tilde of K S, let us call the transform variable S J, must be equal to P tilde K S starting from with I and then Q tilde of I S starting from J. So the Laplace transforms of these probability distributions actually multiply each other because it is in a convolution form straight away. So this implies of course that Q tilde of I S J must be equal to the ratio P tilde of K S J divided by P tilde of K S I. Notice that the left hand side has no K dependence, no dependence on this state at all. So it could have been any state greater than I to the right of I, and it is still valid. So you might ask, how is it that the K dependence here cancels out here? And there is a theorem for Markov processes which says that if the process is stationary in time, then this cancellation is guaranteed, in the sense that this Laplace transform here is the product of a function of J and S and another function of K and S. So the function of K and S cancels out top and bottom. I won't prove this that theorem, it is not very hard to establish, but it can be shown that there is no K dependence. So any K, this of course you are supposed to find by solving the master equation for P, the Fokker-Planck equation for instance, or the master equation. And then once you have that, that ratio is guaranteed to give you the first passage time distribution. That is inverse Laplace transform of this quantity will give you Q of I t for any given j. So that is a very common method, very simple and straightforward method of finding the first passage time distribution. Okay. Now some things about this first passage time distribution should become very clear. One of them is, what is this thing here? This guy here, remember, is integral 0 to infinity dt q e to the minus st q of I t from j. Okay. So that is the meaning of this Laplace transform, the definition here. What should the value of this q tilde be at s equal to 0? Should be equal to 1, because it says if you integrate over all time, this is the probability that you hit I for the first time at time t. And if you integrate over t from 0 to infinity and you get 1, it means that the first passage from the state j to the state I is a sure event. Okay. So the way to check that first passage does occur at all, that it is a sure event, is by doing this, is by finding this q tilde and finding out if at s equal to 0 it is equal to unity or not. First passage namely the probability is equal to 1. If it is less than 1, then you know that the first passage is not a sure event. It is a probability, so it lies between 0 and 1, so you have integrated over all t and added up all these probabilities. Okay. Now notice one thing, notice that this quantity here says this t is the first time of first passage from j to I, so different t's are mutually exclusive events. So one particular value of t and another particular value of t, first passage at 10 seconds excludes first passage at any other time. Okay, so they are mutually exclusive events. Therefore, it makes sense to add them up. You get the total probability that at some time or the other, you will go from J to I. And that's what is normalized out there. Okay, I'll give you an example of a case where it's less than one, a very simple case where it will turn out to be less than one. Similarly, you could ask, what's the time of return to the origin, for example? That's a recurrence time, and we'll come to that a little later. Okay, that's intimately connected with the first passage, but we'll come to that a little later. Okay. What is the mean time of first passage from J to I? What would be the definition of that B? So this is the Laplace transform, and we can ask mean first passage time from J to I. How is it defined in terms of this Q? You multiply by T and you integrate over all T, right? So this, by definition, T J to I equal to integral 0 to infinity dt, T times Q of I T J. That's the definition, assuming that it's normalized to unity. This is the definition, right? Can I extract that from the Laplace transform? Derivative with respect to S will pull down a minus T, so I put another minus sign, and then I set S equal to 0, right? So it's clear that this is also equal to minus d over ds q tilde of I s j evaluated at s equal to 0. So that's a very convenient way of doing things. You work entirely in terms of Laplace transforms. You find out what this quantity is by this ratio, and then differentiate it for the first time once with respect to S, set S equal to 0, put a minus sign, and you got your mean time. Okay. Higher moments can be found similarly. You differentiate each time, you're going to pull down a minus T downstairs. So this is going to give you higher moments as well. Here's an example of when the event of first passage from one point to another is not a sure event. And that has to do with the following. On a line, we can do this on a linear lattice as well. On a line, for example, or even on this lattice, let's do it on this lattice itself. So you have, here's the state I, and here's the state J, and here's the state I, to the right of it. And let's say that there's a random walker who does random walk by jumping to the right one step with probability P or alpha, I've been calling it alpha, and to the left with probability beta. A biased walker. And the lattice extends an infinite extent on either side. This side doesn't matter, but this side extends all the way to infinity. Then we are sure, we can prove, and this can be proved, that if alpha is bigger than beta, first passage from J to I is a sure event. So in this case, it says FPT, FP from J to I is a sure event if alpha is greater than or equal to beta. Even if it's equal to, it still is so. But if alpha is less than beta, then it's not a sure event. The probability that you go from the state J to a state I to the right of it against the bias is less than 1. Okay? It turns out to be 1 minus mod alpha minus beta on an infinite lattice. That's a recurrence probability to the origin, But the first passage thing is related to it, very closely related to it. Okay. But if I put a boundary here at any point and put a reflecting barrier so that the system doesn't escape to minus infinity, but it stays within this region, then even if there's a bias in this direction, it's still a sure event, because the system is then ergodic in this right, to the right of this barrier. It will visit all points. Okay. But the catch is, if alpha is equal to beta, this case, unbiased case, then the mean time to go from here to there, from any j to any I, is infinite. Okay. So the interesting thing is, the event is sure, but the average time it takes to happen is infinite, it diverges. Okay. And I'll show you where this divergence comes from. We're going to look at recurrences a little bit, and I'll tell you where the divergence comes from. What will that imply? That will imply that this fellow here actually diverges, this derivative diverges. And you can sort of tell what's going to happen, when it's going to happen. This integral therefore diverges. This integral doesn't. If you remove this and integrate, which is equivalent to this, it doesn't. That's a sure event. So the integral of q itself converges, but the first moment of q diverges. You put a t there, then because of the range going up to infinity, it diverges. And that derivative diverges. What would that mean? In general, if you say that if you say that q tilde has the following form, this fellow here is, if I expand it in powers of s, if it's analytic at s equal to 0, the first term will be at s equal to 0, and that we know is 1 if it's a sure event, right? So this is 1, and then the next term, if it's an analytic function, will be of the form plus s times dq tilde over ds at s equal to 0, okay, plus higher order terms. Now what does it mean to say that this guy here is infinite, this diverges? What will it imply for this function q tilde? If, for example, q tilde goes like 1 plus order square root of s rather than s, you differentiate square root of s, you get 1 over square root of s in the denominator, and that blows up, right? So the symptom of this, the fact that the time of first passage will become, mean time will become infinite, will show up in the fact that the small s behavior of this q tilde will not be analytic in the neighborhood of s equal to 0. Because if it's analytic, it's got to be an s here by Taylor series, and then this guy is finite, etc. But the moment you have a behavior which goes like 1 plus some power of s less than 1, some positive power of s less than 1, you know that the derivative is going to blow up immediately. And then there will be no sure first, no mean first passage time, which is finite. Okay. So we'll see what these things look like in specific instances. Okay. Similarly for the higher moments, etc. So keep this in mind, that the Laplace transform is going to be a very useful way of deducing the first passage time distribution itself. The other method, which is very common in continuous Markov processes, is the following. Oh, incidentally, we can write down the, just to be sure that we understand what we're talking about, we can write down the first passage time distribution in some cases which we've already looked at, like a random walk, a biased random walk on a line, or for that matter, diffusion on a line. In the case of diffusion on a line, so you have continuous in the x-axis, and say without loss of generality, I start at some point x naught, and I want to hit some point x for the first time. The diffusion occurs on the x-axis, infinitely to the left here. Then the first passage time distribution, now it's continuous, a continuous process. So the first passage time density q, as a function of that you're going to hit the point x for the first time at time t, starting from x naught. So you're going to hit x between t and t plus dt. This is the density, probability density of this random variable t. This quantity is equal to what? For normal diffusion, what does it look like? This is the Levy distribution which we've been talking about, right? So you have the usual diffusion propagators. So it's x minus x naught whole squared over 4 dt. And then you have square root of 4 pi dt, right? But you also have an x minus x naught over t. And that's how you get a t cubed to the power half, and that gives you a Levy distribution in t. This is a stable distribution with exponent half, as I've been saying throughout, okay, in t. So it's just multiplied by this. That's it. This looks almost like a velocity. This is the distance you got to go, and that's the time. Like, what's the mean time now? What's the mean time in this case? Infinity. Infinity. And how do we see that immediately? Up to infinity. You have to multiply this by t. This is going to be your mean time to go from x naught to x. By the way, if x had been to the left of x naught and you have an infinite expanse on the right, then this is modulus of x minus x naught. So it doesn't matter which way you are. There's no bias in this walk. So what is this integral? Given this, what's it going to be? Infinity, because what does this do at t equal to 0? What does this whole thing do at t equal to 0? What's the limit of this as t goes to 0? This factor goes to 0 very strongly. It's like e to the minus positive number over t, and this goes like 1 over t to the 3 halves. That blows up, but that exponent goes to 0 much faster. E to the minus 1 over t goes to 0 extremely fast. So the product goes to 0, no problem over that. What happens at infinity is that this goes to unity, but this integral goes like 1 over t to the 3 halves. So you are stuck with an integral which goes like up to infinity dt over t to the half, because there is a t multiplying it to find the first moment. It cancels this and leaves that alone, and this is infinity. It diverges like square root of the upper limit. So this is equal to infinity. So this is a first passage problem in which you have a sure event. It's for sure that is going to happen because it's possible to check. This is a normalized Levy distribution and its integral equal to 1, but at the same time the mean time is infinite. So in this instance, if you actually computed the Laplace transform of this guy here, you discover that there is no analyticity at s equal to 0. So it starts with 1 and the next term is of order square root of s. And therefore, if you differentiate, you pull a 1 over square root of s and you put s equal to 0, it blows up, which you can see directly from here. Suppose you did this on a lattice. Now we talk about discrete space, then too we can write down the first passage time distribution, no problem. On a lattice, etc. So let's say you start at some state j and here's the state I. Okay. We can write the solution down for this problem. Without loss of generality, let's put the state I to be at 0, for example. And I ask, put j equal to 0, and I want to know what's the mean time to go to this point I for the first time. Well, first I need the solution of the probability distribution itself. And that, as you know, if you had a bias to the right alpha and a bias to the left beta, then the probability that you're going to be at the state I at time t, given that you started at the origin at time 0, this quantity we found what it was. Let's not call it I. I don't want to confuse the square root of minus 1. Let's call it some other state k, some other point k. We wrote this down explicitly. We found what the answer was, right? And what was that? We are in, let's say we are in continuous time, but discrete space, and then the walks are happening with some rate lambda, for example. Pardon me? That's the Skellum distribution, but we need to know what the exact damping factor is in front, right? So if you recall, this is equal to e to the minus lambda t I k of 2 lambda t square root of alpha beta, and then there was an alpha over beta to the power k over 2. That was the distribution. Yeah, quite right. It's related to a Skellum distribution. It's the difference of two Poisson processes, a right jump process with rate lambda alpha and a left jump process with rate lambda beta. And this was the distribution. Exactly as in this case, it turns out that the corresponding q of kt 0 is equal to k over t times this guy, times the same thing. It's almost like distance over time. Now, things are a little interesting because in this case, it turns out that you could have a damping factor because of this when alpha is not equal to beta. Okay. So what you need to do is to integrate this over t and find out if the integral is equal to 1 or not. And my claim is that if alpha is bigger than beta or equal to beta, the integral is 1, but if it is less than beta, the integral is less than 1. Okay. So if you have a forward bias, you are sure to get there. If you have no bias, you are sure to get there. But if you have a negative bias in the other direction, then the probability of getting to that point on the right is less than 1. Okay. So it's not a proper random variable, it's not normalized to unity. You can still say, all right, let's find the probability that it is going to reach that point and take the mean value, mean time to reach there over those realizations. That's it makes sense to do that, but that's a separate exercise. What will happen when there's no bias at all? We saw here that when there's no bias, the first passage was sure, but the mean time was infinite. Now, when you go to a discrete lattice, that shouldn't change really. That property shouldn't change. We should be able to see that directly from here. And indeed you do, because you can see that when alpha is equal to beta equal to half, this two cancels out, you get ik of lambda t. Asymptotically, that goes like e to the lambda t over square root of lambda t. So that factor e to the lambda t cancels out, and you get a 1 over square root of t here. When you put this in here, you get a 1 over t to the 3 halves. Multiply by t, you're back to 1 over t to the half, it diverges. Okay. In exactly the same way, right? So whether it's discrete or continuous doesn't matter. It's still going to be divergent. Now, in the case of continuous processes, there's another way of finding the first passage time, and this has to do with the backward Kolmogorov equation. So now let me mention what that is and show you how it's related to the first passage. If you recall, we introduced the forward Kolmogorov equation or the Fokker-Planck equation by saying if you got a random variable which satisfies this sort of equation, f of x plus a g of x times eta of t, where this was a Gaussian white noise, a general Itô equation of this kind, then we said that the probability p of x t starting from x naught at time z t naught, if it is stationary for instance, a necessary condition is that f and g should be independent of time, but it's not sufficient as we know. We're going to, let me do this for a stationary process, although you can write the same thing down in general. This quantity here satisfies the following equation. Delta x, f of x, p of x t. Let me write it out because you'll see what happens in a minute. given x naught. And the task is to solve it with some initial condition and some boundary conditions. Okay. This is the forward Kolmogorov equation. Which we also call the Fokker-Planck equation. It's a general diffusion process specified by this stochastic differential equation, corresponds to some Markov process, continuous Markov process, corresponds to this Fokker-Planck equation for the conditional probability density. Okay. Now it turns out that you can also show from this same equation that there is another equation satisfied by this quantity P, but with these regarded as the variables rather than the final position and time, right. And that equation reads delta over delta T naught with a minus sign P of x T given x naught T naught, that is equal to, it is the adjoint of this operator, and that becomes a plus delta over delta x naught times an f of x naught p of x t x naught t naught. I need the adjoint of this guy, so f of x naught delta p over delta x naught plus of g squared of x naught okay. Now you have, so for given x and t, this is the equation satisfied in terms of the variables x naught and t naught as the independent variables. This is called the backward Kolmogorov equation. Okay. And now you will see how this is going to help us find first passage time distributions to go from some x naught to some point x, say. Okay. What happens is the following. If you went back to this thing here, notice in particular that the Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process is included here. For the Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process, this g was a constant and this f was just a linear function of just x. Constant times x with a minus sign maybe. Okay. Now the way it works is like this. You have x naught here and you have x here at this point, and I would like to find out what is the time of first passage to go from this x naught to x. Okay. What I have is this probability density. Okay. But this says you are at the point x at time t or in an interval dx at the point about the point x at time t, but you could have gone back and forth in between. So this is not the first passage time density, it is just the probability density function, right. On the other hand, if you say that I am going to end the walk at the point x, the moment it hits x the process is over, what you have to do is to put an absorbing barrier there and then ask what is the first time it takes to hit the absorbing barrier. And that's the point, that's the first passage time we want, right? So you need to solve the diffusion problem with an absorber at x. So the original Fokker-Planck equation, this one, has to be solved with the boundary condition that there's an absorber at x, and not a free boundary condition, it says it vanishes at x equal to plus infinity or anything like that. Now, the way to do that, there are many ways of doing that. After all, this thing here requires you to specify boundary conditions. So, one of the conditions would be that P is 0 at x, once it hits x. So, let us call that solution the absorbing solution. So, let us put absorber, just to make sure that we know what we are talking about. This equation itself, or this equation, has many solutions. To make it unique, you need to put boundary conditions, and the boundary condition that is of relevance to me is to put an absorber at x. Okay. Let me assume that I can then solve this equation in principle. Then, to find out what is the rate at which the particle is hitting this point, that is going to be my first passage time density. I want to find q of x t given x naught. This is what I want to find explicitly. I argue in the following way. I have this equation here, the backward equation, and I can write this delta over delta t naught if the process is stationary. Everything is a function of t minus t naught. I can write d over dt naught as minus d over dt. So, I can write this side as delta over delta t p absorber x t x naught t naught equal to this whatever it is on the right hand side. Okay. And let me call this x prime. On this side I have f of x naught delta over delta x naught p absorber of x prime t x naught t naught. By the way, I can get rid of this t naught now, it is completely stationary, so this is gone. T minus t naught, everything is a function of t minus t naught, so you can set equal to 0, so this is gone. P absorber x prime t x naught. Write it in this fashion. And let us integrate both sides with respect to x prime from minus infinity up to x. The final point x prime, I am going to integrate up to x. Remember, the walk ends once it hits x. So, p is 0 at x, and beyond that it is 0. But I now integrate up to x, and I can put that here. This in, so once I put that integral in, let us call, so I have integral minus infinity up to x dx prime p of x absorber at x x prime t starting from x naught. That is going to appear everywhere. So I can take this integral inside up to this point, because it is integration over x prime alone. Similarly, these are all x naughts, so I put that in here. These are all x naughts, I put that in here. Integral. And I end up with that quantity there, and x prime is finished, it is integrated over. The answer is a function of t, it is a function of x naught of course, and of x, where the barrier is. What is the physical meaning of that quantity? This says you start at t equal to 0 at x naught, and you are integrating over the entire range up to x, to the left of x, the probability density. Okay. So, what is this equal to? You are integrating over x prime, this final point. This thing here is equal to the probability that your random variable, which is x, at time t is less than or equal to this quantity x, if you integrate up to x, right? Given that you started, with x of 0 equal to x naught, that is the initial condition. So, it is the probability that you started here and at time t, you are still in this range. So, it is the survival probability. it's the probability that you have survived in the safe region to the left of the trap till time x, till time t. Okay. So I should call this the survival probability in minus infinity x. So, could call it, for example, survival probability till time t. So, it's a function of x, it's a function of t, and it's of course a function of x naught. That the walk is not extinguished; it's not been absorbed yet. If this is the survival probability at time t, what's the rate at which it's disappearing? 1 minus this is the total probability, right. So, what is the probability density? The derivative of this, right. So, the derivative of 1 minus s of t is going to be the rate at which it is going to hit that point x, right. Therefore, q of x t given x naught equal to d over dt 1 minus s of t x t x naught is equal to minus ds over dt. Okay. So, put a minus sign here, a minus here and a minus here. And you guaranteed that this quantity is equal to q. This guy here is equal to q of x t x naught. So you have an equation for this guy. It's convenient to use Laplace transforms now. Then things become a little easier. And you get an ordinary differential equation here in x naught, which you solve with suitable boundary conditions, and you have your first passage time distribution. Okay. So, this is how the backward Kolmogorov equation will tell you what first passages are, not just for the ordinary diffusion problem, but anything which has a stochastic differential equation of this kind, in particular things like the Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. So, to tell you when any point is hit for the first time, what the time, what the distribution in time is of this first passage. So, it is not saying anything like the first passage is sure or anything like that. You have to solve this to discover what it is, what this first passage time distribution looks like. Okay. So, I thought I would do this just to explicitly show you how for Markov processes, you assume Markov processes here, this works, how this whole thing works. We saw that on a lattice yesterday, we saw on a linear lattice how this system actually gave us the mean first passage time. We could solve it easily. It was in the case of we found the mean first passage time, but you could actually find the distribution itself. We have seen today that explicit ways of finding distributions. The problem we looked at yesterday was something starting at the origin and hitting either plus j or minus j, barriers at two ends. For that, you got to solve the diffusion problem with two barriers, both of which are reflecting barriers. So, you have to put two boundary conditions saying that the walk ends if it hits either plus j or minus j, and that is it. Okay. So, one can write down explicit solutions, but I would like to do a little more. I would like to show you, we need to do fractals. So, I need to show you how the walk dimensionality changes and so on. But before that, let me introduce the idea of a random walk dimension, because we are going to do this on other structures as well. And I want to show you what happens, because when we do anomalous diffusion, this will become crucial. Yesterday we found that on a linear lattice of this kind, if you are at 0 and you start at 0 and you go to plus or minus 1 every time step you take nearest neighbor time steps, then we discovered that to go to a site either j or minus j on this side for the first time t to go from 0 to plus or minus j for the first time was equal to j square. We showed this explicitly starting from 0. So to travel at distance j in an unbiased walk, it took you the square of this distance. That was the mean time it took. So it, in particular, it means that to go twice as far, you need 4 times as long. That's what it immediately implies. And that you can see right from the beginning, you can see that if I start at 0 and here's 1, here's minus 1, well, the mean time it takes to go unit time step is 1 in this case, because if in one time step you either go here or here and the matter is over. But you want to go here or here, now it's a different story, because you can go from here and back, here and any number of times, you do back and forth, and then you of course finally hit that for the first time, right. So it, now it's using the general formula j squared, the answer is going to be 4 in this case, right. So to go twice as far, it takes 4 times as long. That's the moral of this story, right. So the question is, how do I define a walk dimension in this case? So the way I do it is as follows. You say that to go a distance r squared goes like t to the power 2 over dw. If I say this here, then it's clear that r1 squared over r2 squared, if I take 2 different distances, then the times taken must be of the form t1 over t2 to the t over dw. And this thing is called the random walk dimension. Now if I say I'm going twice as far, then r2 is twice r1, so this implies that 1/4 equal to t1 over t2, the 2 over dw, which says that 2 log 2 equal to 2 over dw log t2. Over to you. Or this cancels, or it tells you dw. Okay. So we have a general definition of what this walk dimensionality is. It says take 2 distances, one of them twice the other. Find the mean times it takes to go to these 2 distances. Take the log of the ratio, divide by log 2, and that's equal to the walk dimension. In the case we just looked at, t2 was over t1 was 4. So you got a 2 log 2 here and a log 2 here. So you had dw equal to 2, which we always knew, because we've got r squared goes like t to the power 1. So for standard random walks, normal random walks, the standard diffusive processes, d walk is equal to 2 always. And this is independent of the dimensionality of the space in which things happen. Brownian motion, the random walk dimension is 2, standard. But now we are going to look at structures where this is not going to be 2, it's going to be greater than 2. And the way it will happen is that the structure has got little complications, little nooks and crannies where the particle can get lost for a long time and change the dimensionality itself. We'll look at that explicitly here. But to set the stage for that, we need to go back to what these structures look like. They are called fractals or hierarchical structures. And let me first introduce you to these fractals, and then we will look at specific examples. So let me first ask, are you already familiar with the idea of fractals? How many here are not familiar at all with what a fractal is? How many don't know what a fractal is? Because if you do know what a fractal is, then I will go ahead and use. No?
Not in detail.
Not in detail? Okay. Let me give a quick introduction to this business. Okay. Very roughly speaking, what a fractal is, there's many ways of defining it, is to start with some geometrical construction and then iterate this construction over and over again in such a manner that the figure you get is self-similar, that with suitable magnification or demagnification, depending on how you look at it, it is exactly the same as the previous figure, except that there are cases when you have random fractals where the self-similarity is statistical rather than exact. Okay. It's a little bit like saying that if you got a sufficiently irregular landscape, for instance, and you go closer and look at it, it also is equally irregular. And in some sense, if this statistical similarity of this landscape remains the same, you would say it's a fractal of some kind, etc. But the more precise definition is as follows, and it takes into account the fact that these fractal objects generally are not smooth objects because of the manner of construction. They would be irregular objects, they would be curves. If they are curves, they are not differentiable. If they are surfaces, they are not smooth, they are rough on all scales and so on. And the simplest of these is the so-called Koch curve, the triadic Koch curve, and the construction proceeds as follows. So, you start with a line of unit length, okay, and then you put a kink on it. So, you take 1/3 of this and then you put a kink on it. So, this is still 0 and 1, but you put a little kink on it. Each of these is of size 1/3. So, here's 1/3, here's 1/3, here's 1/3, here's 1/3 in length. But now you got a curve of length 4/3. Okay. And the next step, you do the same thing. You take this little segment and you put a kink on it. That segment, you put a kink on it. And so on. This is still 0 to 1, but now the length of this curve has increased, of course, because this portion is 1 over 9, the original portion, as you can see, and there is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 of them. So the total length is now 16 over 9, and you keep doing this, and it is quite clear that between 0 and 1, you will now have an extremely kinky object which will not be differentiable anywhere in the limit and whose actual length is infinite. Actual physical length will diverge. And the question is, how does it diverge with the scale factor? Now, it is clear that this fellow is 1/3 the original guy. So, what has happened is that the original length unit interval has been broken up into 4 pieces, each of which is 1/3 the original piece. So, the scaling down is by a factor 1/3, but the number of pieces has increased and it has become 4 and not 3, if it remained 3, then of course, nothing there going on, right. So, one can ask, how is this length going to diverge as I keep increasing the generation? In what way does it diverge? Okay. And that is measured exactly as I measured, as I gave for the walk dimension, again by taking ratios in this case. So, at any stage, if epsilon is your scale factor, you compute the log of the number of pieces of size epsilon divided by the log of 1 over epsilon. Epsilon is less than 1. So, 1 over epsilon will have a positive log. Okay. This will tell you precisely how the length diverges as epsilon, as the generation increases. Okay. In this case, the limit is very trivial. I can take it at any stage, and the reason is that it is a regular fractal, because each generation's relation to the previous generation is exactly the same as the next generation's relation to this present generation. Nothing changes at all. So, these things do not depend on generation at all. This is a regular fractal here. And in this case, so this is called the fractal dimension. There is a symbol for it, d fractal. And what's that equal to in the present case? This is log 4 divided by log 3, which is greater than 1. So this curve, it's also called a snowflake curve if you did this with an equilateral triangle to start with. This curve has got a name, it's called the triadic Koch curve, has a fractal dimension of this. Now what's meant by this thing? This object here in the limit, is a continuous curve. It's in a bounded region of space, doesn't go very far, right? But its length is infinite. Its formal length is actually infinite. If we went on this curve over every nook and corner, it's infinite, right? So what is happening is that if you took a gross scale, if you took a foot rule and measured its length, and here's my foot rule, it's got a least count of some one unit, for example, then it would be one unit fits here, right? I put that on this, and that resolution I still see one. But if I have a foot rule which has got a better resolution, at least one third resolution, then of course it's this. And now I say the length is 4/3. And if I got a better foot rule, even more refined, the next time around it's going to be 4/3 squared, 16/9, and so on. And the length is actually diverging with the resolution. So these fractal curves have properties that depending on how fine your measurement apparatus is, you get a different answer in any units whatsoever. It's not just a question of choice of units, in any units whatsoever. So if the original length was 1 meter, you really see 4/3 meter here and then 16/9 meters there, and so on. But you need a finer resolution to do this. Now for a smooth curve, this property is not there at all. For a smooth curve of this kind, no matter what resolution you use, you're still going to see exactly the same length. The topological dimension of that curve is 1, and its actual fractal dimension is also 1. But in this case, the topological dimension is 1, but the fractal dimension is greater than 1. And what's this dimensionality has another name in this simple instance. It's called the box counting dimension, because if we want to count a volume, for instance, what would you do? Take small cubes and see how many cubes fit into this volume. If the cubes are sufficiently fine, all nooks and crannies will be covered and you'll get a certain answer, right? Now the statement here is, how many of these boxes do you need to count what the dimensionality is? And the box counting dimension is greater than the topological dimension. It turns out to be log 4 over log 3 in this case, okay? So this is the idea behind what a fractal is. For our purposes, it's a geometrical object for which there is a hierarchical way of constructing it. And the topological dimension of this object is in general smaller than the box counting dimension. But the box counting dimension is in all cases less than the Euclidean dimensions into which this curve is embedded, this object is embedded. Here I've drawn it on a plane. The plane's topological dimension is 2. So the fractal dimension of this object cannot be greater than 2. It's on a plane. That's the end of the story, right? So it's bounded on the top from above by the topological dimension of the Euclidean space into which you embed it. And it's bounded from below by the topological dimension of this object, and it's somewhere in between. Could be a fractal, could be a fraction, or an irrational number of this kind. There could be cases when you have a fractal, but that fractal has a fractal dimension which approaches 2. So there are constructions for these so-called piano curves or space-filling curves for which the box counting dimension will approach 2 in the limit. That's the maximum it can be, because these are planar curves, right? So in that case, it's not a fractional dimension. The fractal dimension happens to be an integer in those cases. Brownian motion does that. So if I set a particle in Brownian motion on this plane, it does this crazy thing like this, and I can ask, what is the fractal dimension of this Brownian motion of this Wiener process, it turns out to be 2 in this case. So it is actually space filling. And that's because you're guaranteed that with probability 1, every point will be visited and visited infinitely often. So the whole space is filled up given enough time. Okay. This is an example of a statistical fractal. Nobody is saying that this is a regular fractal, so you can't give a construction, neat construction of this kind to do this. But this object here is again a fractal nevertheless. And the fact that the walk dimensionality turned out to be 2 is linked to the fact that the box counting dimension of Brownian motion is 2. It is linked closely to that. Okay. Now what we intend to do is to look at another problem of a random walk on another fractal structure, which is a little more interesting than this. This guy is not very interesting because it's still a linear object in this one-dimensional object topologically. We'd like to have something with nooks and crannies and so on, with some ramification, more than one way of getting from one point to another, and then we'll see if interesting things happen. You see, in this problem, to go from here to there, you have to go along this curve at any stage. So it's not a very interesting problem in that sense. But if you had loops and things like that, then things become more complex and interesting. So we will look at one of those fractals called the Sierpinski gasket as a kind of case study of a non-trivial fractal in which you can get answers which depart from the usual Euclidean space here. Okay. By the way, you can, just as I defined this fractal curve, you can also define more complicated objects, far more complicated, and the Sierpinski gasket is one of them. And then we will generalize that to higher dimensions. You can define any number of dimensions, see what those fractals look like. And then we do random walk on that to see what will happen to this whole thing. Okay. But essential to the whole approach is the fact that this object is self-similar. Okay. If you look at this piece and magnify it, it's this. If you look at this piece and magnify it, it's this. Or demagnify, you go in the other direction. You get exactly the same thing over and over again, repeated. Okay. So this self-similarity is the defining characteristic of a fractal object here. All the other properties may or may not exist in equal measure, but the self-similarity is completely crucial, either regular self-similarity or statistical self-similarity in some sense. I'll say more about this as we go along. Okay, so let me stop here today and take it from this point tomorrow.